wireless security. How does it work? What protocol should you be using and why? So we're going to talk about what security protocols are used for wireless networks and maybe some other security settings that are available that might have some effect, might not. So we're going to talk about securing your wireless networks. Here's your options. Your options start at the top with open access wireless networks, all the way down to potentially WPA3 at some point in the future. Let's talk about what those are. First of all, open access networks. That means it's completely open. You've been there, Starbucks, Wi-Fi, wherever, where you go and you don't need a password. You just walk in and connect to the network. What that means right now is anybody can connect. What that also means is that anybody can listen to what's going on that network, even if they're not necessarily connected to the network. They're able to sit there, listen, and observe what's going on. Now, what that does not mean is that they're able to understand and intercept and manipulate and view all traffic on the network. If you're connected to an HTTPS website or an FTPS server or SSH using secure protocols and encrypted protocols, they're not going to be able to see and intercept and view what's going on. They could see that there is encrypted traffic. They could save it for later, but they're not able to see what is there because that's all encrypted using good, strong, secure protocols. But if you're on an unencrypted website, then you're out of luck, and anybody who wants to can listen, observe, and intercept whatever traffic they want. So next, after an open, completely unencrypted network is WEP, which stands for Wired Equivalent Privacy. The name is a lie. The idea was that it was going to provide privacy equivalent to being on a wired network, and maybe for a little while that was true, but now it's broken, don't use it. WEP, it's an option in some older Wi-Fi routers and things. It shouldn't be an option anymore. It's just as good as not using any encryption at all. It's completely broken. Anybody who wants to can observe it. The best thing that WEP is good for is keeping your nosy neighbor off your network. That's about it. It's not good for keeping your tech-savvy neighbor off your network, and it's not good for protecting your privacy inside your Wi-Fi network. So after WEP came WPA, and you'll notice I skipped WPA1 completely. We're going straight on to WPA2 because WPA2 is the one that exists now that you should be using. Wi-Fi Protected Access version 2, WPA V1 was broken essentially just like WEP, but Wi-Fi Protected Access version 2 is not, at least not that we know of, not in the same way. Now, it is vulnerable if you have a terrible password. So make sure that your key for your Wi-Fi network is very long and very random. If you have a terrible password, it's vulnerable and it's possible for someone to connect to that. Now, there have been some issues, and if you want to look more into it, you can look up the crack vulnerability. There's been some issues with WPA2 networks and some vulnerabilities identified, but those have currently been patched, and so far WPA2 is still the state of the art and it works and does what we want. So this is the one that you should be using on all of your Wi-Fi networks that you control. Now someday we're going to have WPA3. It exists, the protocol has been finalized, it's there, and it's just not available on most devices yet. It's starting to get there. Someday you'll have it on your devices. And WPA3 adds some cool features, some things that WPA2 ignored, but it's just not widely available yet. Again, maybe in a year, maybe in a couple years, what WPA3 will be the standard, but for now, WPA2 is really the way to go. Now, benefits of encrypting your Wi-Fi. First of all, you've got protection from outside snooping. Again, if you don't encrypt your Wi-Fi, anybody who wants to can listen in to what's going on your network. And it prevents anybody from the outside from being able to just sit and listen. And I say promiscuous mode here. That's a setting on some Wi-Fi devices that you can set that tells them to listen to everything, even to networks they're not connected to. So if you've got a specialized antenna and want to be able to listen and pick up your neighbor's Wi-Fi signal without connecting to it, you would enable something called promiscuous mode that would enable it to start listening and recording those packets, even if it's not connected to the network. So that's where that comes in, protecting from the outside. It also protects from inside snooping. So you might think that, hey, if I encrypt my Wi-Fi, But if someone manages to get connected to the Wi-Fi, then they can snoop on everything that's going on the Wi-Fi. And that's not true. Each device uses its own key to communicate with the Wi-Fi access point, meaning that only that device is able to decrypt that communication, meaning it's protecting you from inside snooping as well. Everybody on your Wi-Fi network isn't able to see all of your Wi-Fi traffic, which is kind of nice. So as far as setting up that encryption, there's actually a couple different ways that you can set up the encryption on your Wi-Fi network. The most common one, the one that you've used a bajillion times in home networks, is called a pre-shared key. And that is, you know, your network password. What's your Wi-Fi password? That is exactly what it is. And again, it's used for home Wi-Fi all the time. And it's great for home Wi-Fi because, you know, you set up your password, you can give it to your neighbors, you can give it to your friends, and everybody can connect and it's no problem. But as you may have discovered, it's not super great if you need to change the password. And it's also not super great if you really want a secure network, because a shared secret isn't a secret. I think the saying is two people can keep a secret if one of them is dead. And if you're setting up a network, say a corporate network with 100 people or 1,000 people or 10,000 employees who are all on this network, well, having a pre-shared key means that everybody has the key to that network. And this also makes it a challenge if you fire somebody. If you fire an employee, you may not necessarily want them on the internal network, which means that, what, how are you going to kick them off if they know the password? You can't. You could change the password. But then the other 9,999 employees that you have all have to update their devices, and everything that's on the network gets kicked off, and all that chaos ensues. So pre-shared keys are great for home networks. They're fantastic for your coffee shop or whatever. Not ideal long-term for a larger company or really any company. So there's another protocol called RADIUS. And RADIUS stands for Remote Dial-In User Service. And what RADIUS does is, you've used it before probably. The Edge of Rome network is an example of a RADIUS-driven network. There is not a single key for the entire network. There is a remote dial-in user service, which means that you use a username and a password. And each individual user that connects to the network uses that username and password connecting to a centralized authentication server. So you try to connect to the network with your username and password. The access point passes that along, says, okay, yes, you're authorized, boom, you're in. And that gives you a unique username and password per user, which means if you fire someone, you can revoke their access to the Wi-Fi and they're no longer allowed. Or when you graduate, you're no longer allowed access to the Edge of Rome network. So then your username and password are deleted from the authentication database and you can no longer get on, which means everybody else can still authenticate, but you can't, which is what you want inside of a company network. Being able to remove one user from the network is something that you can do with RADIUS that you can't do as well with a pre-shared key. So next, let's talk about some less effective security measures. So there's lots of them. There's things that are out there. You might have seen, hey, do this to secure your network. And maybe you've considered them, maybe you've enabled them. But here we're going to talk about why they're not as effective as maybe they are sold. And these are MAC filtering and disabling your SSID broadcast. So MAC filtering is a way to set up your network so that only certain MAC addresses are allowed. And it sounds really nice, right? To be able to say, okay, well, these MAC addresses are the only ones allowed. Nothing else is allowed on the network. And that's fine. It does provide some level of security, but unfortunately, you've got MAC spoofing. MAC spoofing is a way that you can set the MAC address of your device to whatever you want it to be. And your phone can do it, your laptop can do it, your desktop can do it, whatever device you want. Can set up MAC spoofing, can pretend to be whatever MAC address you want. And so it gets around these MAC filtering rules. So you can enable it, but really all it does is make things more inconvenient for you, not necessarily any more inconvenient for an attacker who's already determined to get on your network anymore. I mean, it's not any better than just having a good password and using the right encryption protocols. The other thing you might have seen is disabling SSID broadcast. Now, SSID is the service set identifier, and the service set identifier is commonly, you know, the name of your network. So your network might be called Edge of Rome. It might be called Pretty Fly for a Wi-Fi. It might be called Get Off My LAN. There's lots of things that you can name your Wi-Fi network, and that is the SSID. And you can disable the broadcast, which means that when you click your little window to connect to a list of Wi-Fi networks and your computer or your phone shows you a list of the available Wi-Fi networks, yours wouldn't show up in that list. Again, all that's going to do is keep people from accidentally clicking on it, which doesn't really cause you any harm. Anybody who wants to can walk by and observe the traffic using that promiscuous mode, watch traffic on your network, and pick up the SSID from the traffic that's there. So disabling the broadcast, again, it's something that you can do, but it doesn't really add any security compared to just using a good WPA2 password on your network. So one last little thing I wanted to talk about before we go is the WiFi Pineapple. This is a specialized Wi-Fi security device. It looks like this. It's got some antennas on it, and it's specifically designed to attack, monitor, observe, map, and do all the bad things that you can do to a network built into this little piece of hardware here. So it can do man-in-the-middle attacks. You can map networks with it. So this can set itself up as an evil twin, meaning it sets itself up as a second access point that looks exactly like the real access point, hoping that devices will accidentally or purposely connect to it instead of the real access point and be able to intercept traffic going through those. So all things that this Wi-Fi Pineapple device is for, if you're interested in getting into Wi-Fi hacking, the Wi-Fi Pineapple is a good way to start. So before we go, check yourself as always. First of all, what Wi-Fi encryption protocol should you be using, and which are the protocols maybe that you should not be using? And what are the benefits of encrypting your Wi-Fi network compared to, say, an open access network?